we had Mahatma Prema from Norway, who had a very interesting Devi Parashakti Akashic reading. And she is here to share her experience. She has been with us before, and she's coming back, joining us back again today to share her experience of Devi Parashakti Akashic reading. Nityananda Mahatma Prema.
Nityananda Ma.
Nityananda Ma, welcome back to Nityananda TV. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me again. This will be the third time that I'm sharing since the Devi Parashakti Darshan on the 1st of this month, so 9 days ago.
Beautiful. And maybe to our viewers, you can give a brief of what Devi Parashakti revealed to you, what was her blessing to you, and then we can move into your share.
If I can read it, Ma, it will be easier for me to. Okay. Okay. So on the 1st of June, Devi Parashakti answered my question after many, many weeks. I had never had an answer before, despite having asked the questions. So when this happened, it was a very intense, moving moment for me. And this was the answer that Devi had given. Listen well to what is being told, daughter. You are one of the beings who came down from Kailasa to be a co-captain and serve the world to protect it from the terrible corona. You forgot the purpose of coming and diverted into another life. Such beings as you, who came from Kailasa, are also the reasons for this terrible pralaya. Forgetting the divine seva you need to do and leaving the work you are meant to do, you are doing some other work. Like you and other such beings who came from Kailasa have become the reason for this great drama. For 3 days, think about what I told. I will make you realize it in your dream, waking state, and consciousness. I will show you the truth. Once you see it, I will give prayaschitta. Go and come, a virtuous one. So this answer to me was just, it was very intense, because the moment this came to me, this answer, it hit me right in the gut. I knew it was the truth. The moment it was said, I felt it. And then I sat with it, and I waited, and I allowed the words to sink in. And it has taken these number of days to realize just the kind of the weight of the responsibility and what we've come here and the purpose with which we're supposed to be here.
And when Devi Parashakti said, you know, just I will reveal things to you, and I will tell you what you need to do. The way, when I heard it, the way I see it is, you know, really reawakening to the true purpose of your life, you know, realigning us back to the real purpose of our life, which is what will give us fulfillment. That is what we came to this planet Earth for. And when we drift away from the purpose, she gives us a strong wake-up call and realigns us back and tells us, you know what, this is what you came for. And when she shared this with you, Atma Prema, what really went inside you? What was the experience that you had? And what was the realization that came from the within you?
So, Ma, if I can go back to the beginning. So if I can share that my meeting with Swamiji, when I first met Swamiji, this happened in 2004. And I was in Oklahoma City at that time, and in the US. And I had graduated from college. I was looking for a job. And this was about 17 years ago. I was 21 years old. And this, I just saw a flyer on my aunt's table. And she invited me to attend the temple in Oklahoma City. And I went. And the moment Swamiji stepped out of the car, not knowing anything about him from the past, I just knew that I knew this person, that my being automatically recognized something, and something shifted within me, which I didn't even understand at that time and that moment. And from then on, life just took on a different color. I had purpose. There was so much peace. There was so much joy. There was an intensity. And all those words, these words are actually pale in comparison to what that feeling was like. And it was being around Swamiji and being initiated and having the darshans everything was just auspiciousness unfolding every second. It was manifesting, and just being in that breathing space was auspiciousness. It was everything that unfolded. It felt like you were living not on earth but on a different plane of existence. So each time leaving that space in his physical presence was so unbearable, and it was very hard because you felt like, okay, I want to be around the master, I want to be around the guru in his physical presence all the time. But at the time, a few years later, I moved back to the place I was born and grew up in, which was in Dubai in the Middle East. And I would often go to Adi Kailash and, you know, attend various programs and get you know, the teachings and understandings and being in that breathing space. And every time I had to leave, it was like this separation was so hard. It was so unbearable to leave that space of Adi Kailash. But also knowing that everything that I had imbibed from the teachings, it was important for me to go out and go back and do that seva and just share with the people who were in the Sangha in Dubai at the time. And all they wanted to do was, you know, listen to the stories and the sharings and just taste that, the joy and the bliss, and, you know, and enriching was just, it came with so much ease. It was just a natural process that all of us just kept doing. So at the time, I didn't even realize what was happening, but I took up the responsibility of the Sangha in the Middle East and in Dubai specifically. And at the time, I was about 24 and the youngest coordinator for the mission at that time. And wow. I can't say that I knew anything about Hinduism or Sanatana Dharma. I had, you know, I grew up in Dubai, a Middle Eastern country. The most we had exposure was when we would visit India to visit our family and go to temples. But beyond that, there was not much understanding. So I didn't have any depth of knowledge around Vedas or Shastras, and I couldn't chant. It was not like I could chant and everyone was impressed or anything like that. There was no prior knowledge and or experience before meeting Swamiji. So all that I came back to share every time after those visits to Adi Kailash was just sweet, simple stories that was just shared from intense bhakti, that devotion, that sweet devotion that comes through you just by being, you know, just being in that oneness with Swamiji. And every time it was like a cloud that kept me floating through everything that I encountered in life, whether it was through work, through relationships, through the Sangha, everything. It was just such a beautiful flow. And just having that simple devotion, that simple trust, and just taking that simple action, the response was so incredible. You know, the satsang grew, the Sangha grew, and the satsangs that we were hosting in devotees' homes. Every week we would have satsangs that would keep moving from different devotees' homes because everyone wanted to host it. And we could not no longer, and many of the people had not even met Swamiji. And there weren't too many things happening on social media at that time, unlike today. And people would just come because that bhakti was felt. And we had to form a center legally and officially. And in that center, we would have our Nitya Yoga, we would have our satsangs, we would have our youth group meetings. And eventually a Kalpathru happened in January of 2010. And this was just created by a handful of people who felt that deep connection to Swamiji. You know, so why I'm saying all this, Ma, is because kind of to give a little bit of context and background to what has happened, where I've come from, and what happened in between. So during this time, this was 6 years with Swamiji, being so closely associated, there were a lot of questions. And I was 21 when I met Swamiji. And so there were a lot of questions from family. There were doubts raised, you know, why do you need to have a guru? You are too young. When will you get married? You know, you're getting older. So there was all this pressure from the society and to my parents specifically. And it was hard to be able to convey to them just what having a guru and having Swamiji in our life was like. I mean, the countless blessings, the healings that had happened, it was too many to share. And all we did at that time was just continued on and just turned, you know, deaf ears to what they were saying. Because I knew the person I had become, and the shift that had happened in me was so obvious to my family and then to my friends. And people were drawn to that and wanted to know who it was that I followed that kept me so much at peace and so centered with such unwavering faith despite any sort of ups and downs one experiences in life, whether it's through job or relationships. They could just see that it was with such ease that I was flowing through life, and I felt it. And I felt Swamiji's presence with me all the time. So what happened after all of this was that in June of 2009, a group of core devotees from Dubai, the Dubai Sangha, we all attended the Inner Awakening program. And we attended it together. It was such a beautiful 21 days. And then some of us extended our stay because we weren't ready to leave. And it was that time that Swamiji, after much of us asking and hoping and praying, Swamiji announced that there would be plans to come to Dubai and host the Kalpathru program for about 2 days. It was the plan for Swamiji and some of the senior Swamis to come and come to Dubai. So immediately after we returned to Dubai, we work was underway. We had to organize, we had to plan, we had to make so many arrangements. We had to raise donations and manage an entire program. And we didn't know how many people would come. We were just a handful of us. I mean, it was satsangs were there, but we weren't sure how many people would actually attend. And so with all of this, we just surrendered to that moment and said, with absolute trust and devotion, we said, it'll happen. Swamiji has said it. Now it just has to happen. We're just part of that process. And then people started registering. Donations started coming in. And it all just unfolded so beautifully. That surrender and that whole process was just, we could see the divine play in all of that. So, receiving Swamiji, hosting the Kalpathru, having so many senior Swamis in attendance was really like literally a dream and something we never thought could happen in a place like Dubai and especially in the Middle East. So it was a successful program. Over 500 people attended from different parts of the Middle East. And, riding on this high of the experience, some of us were planning on attending the Kumbh Mela, so which is the biggest religious gathering. And, we were thinking, what better way is there to experience a spiritual gathering like this than with one's own beloved guru? So this is now all the background. And leading up to then, what happened next was I was to take a flight on the 3rd of March in 2010 and head to Bangalore and come to Adi Kailash and with a group of people, get together and then go to Kumbh Mela with Swamiji. And just before taking the flight, I got a call from one of the devotees in Dubai. And they said that there has been some news that's broken out. And I think you should be aware of it because you might consider not taking the flight and not going to India. So I heard what he had to say. I understood that there was what was happening, but I didn't pay attention to it. I said, no, this is decided. I'm going to go. So I arrive the morning of March 3rd. And now India it's early morning. So a lot of India hasn't woken up to the news that has just come out on TV in India. And as I arrived to Adi Kailash, that feeling of excitement and, building that, okay, I'm back here. I'm back home. And I saw some people outside the campus and they looked like reporters. So, okay, I didn't think much of it. And I thought, okay, maybe this is related to whatever the news is. So go into the campus and find that everything is very silent. Everything is so eerily silent, actually. Just couldn't see anyone. I passed a devotee on the way who was responsible for some of the temple activities, and I asked him. He was a devotee in Dubai who moved with his wife to be at the temple and take care. And he said the temple wasn't open. So I thought that was quite strange, you know. So, but I thought, okay, let me go, and maybe it's still too early, and let me go and register at the admin office and then just do all the formalities around, you know, checking in and everything. So then we congregated, like a few of the foreigners and everyone who had arrived, got together in the food hall, and then we were hearing bits and pieces of information, and we weren't sure what was happening, but something was going on. But we were kept safe, and we were told to be in a secured location, and, you know, at in time we would be given some more information. And later on we heard that the Gurukul had been set on fire by a mob of people. And so
that was the exact same day, Akhabrima, just to let all our viewers know. That was the day when the, you know, the religious persecution on the Supreme Court of India was just 24 hours before had come out, and the Swamiji was going through a series of assassination attempts, and it was the residents of the Supreme Court of Hinduism, you know, being burnt, along with Gurukul and along with so many other places, with Supreme Court of being locked inside their own monastery, and that was being light recasted. And all this was happening, and the people who were there, I was there in the Adinam on that day, and none of us were allowed to, you know, go to protect Swamiji or protect any other parts of the place. And all of us were cordoned off completely. And there was a complete police who were actually protecting the anti-Hindu elements to destroy the monastery, and they were not allowing us to go stop or do anything. And that's exactly when I think you were also there, happened to be there in the monastery at that same time. Yes, please go ahead.
Yes, Ma. And at the time, we didn't know what was happening. But of course, much later on, I understood. But at this moment in time, it was very disconcerting, you know. But it was ensured that we were all kept safe. You know, all of our, you know, we were kept in a place that nobody could reach us, and we felt secure. We didn't feel threatened by any way, but we knew something big was happening. So that night, two devotees from the city came and, you know, whisked us away, actually, from the campus, saying that it's getting out of control. There's a lot of people, and, you know, we need to take you back into the city and be safe. Your parents, you know, are worried and all of that. So we were put into a car. We were asked to remove any sort of anything related to Swamiji. We were asked to remove the mala, the bracelet, everything that, you know, was part of us. We had to just kind of remove and keep aside, so that in case we were stopped along the way, that we were not harassed or bothered. So we get into the city, and all the news channels are incessantly airing a video over and over and over. And it was just, I'd never seen anything like that being done with such consistency. It was as if that was all every news channel could do and report on. So it had the effect of visually affecting people, you know. And I decided, at my parents' insistence, that I should return to Dubai and not remain in India longer. And I did that, and then I felt confused, and I didn't speak to anybody, you know. And I neither tried to reach out to the administrators of the Adinam, Adi Kailash, nor did anyone contact me, because so much was happening at the time, and they were all trying to keep themselves protected as well. And so I kept a low profile for months, and this was right after a hugely successful Kalpathru program that had happened in January of that, just 2 months before. I mean, literally, it was January, and now we're talking about March, and people are expecting to hear information, and now this has happened. So I didn't know.
I just wanted to add to you, Mark, remember, because I was there in the monastery at that time, and, you know, we were just trying to ensure Swamiji's life was safe. Now, see, Swamiji was going through a series of assassination attempts, and over a span of about from the 2nd of March till 21st of April, just in that 1 month and 1.5 months, his car was followed everywhere. Swamiji was at least had about, I think, more than 70 assassination attempts just in the month and a half. Every place there were people who were ready to, you know, burn him alive, ready to kill him, ready to, you know, do all sorts of things. And it was all, and with the police protection. Means the people who came to attack, they came with police protection for them. You know, so there is no way we could do anything. So the whole administration at that time was focused on somehow we want to just somehow ensure Swamiji's life is safe. You know, that was what was there for us. We just wanted Swamiji to be alive for what he was doing to humanity and what he has done to humanity and what he has done to all of us. That was what was going on. And we really couldn't, you know, expect this level of a multi-pronged attack from every side. And I remember on the 3rd of March, there was an inquiry from 11 government departments trying to, you know, shut down the bank, trying to shut down the monastery, trying to shut down the gurukul, trying to shut down the temple, trying to, you know, get all of us out. I was there and we were literally forced to leave. They said, no, everything is closing. You have to leave. All the Adinavasis, we were forced to leave. You know, the bank accounts were getting frozen. Swamiji was being attacked everywhere, every step of the way. And that was what was going on in India at the time, you know. Just to let you know, and for all our viewers also, you know, at that moment, this continuous airing of this false news, so much of hate speech, and everywhere people are, you know, barging into the monasteries and temples and breaking the deities and abusing sexually, like female monks getting sexually abused, and everywhere it was just completely out of hands. Even if we have had the best of the administration, you know, it was just impossible to handle the attack that was happening from all directions on, you know, a small group of people who are trying to manage. And that most priority at the time was we wanted Swamiji's body to be safe.
Yes, Ma. And what shocked me the most, and I didn't even think in too deeply about it, but what hit me on the surface was that it wasn't just in India, but everywhere. It was news channels in Dubai, in the Middle East, and everywhere. It was seemed as if it was, now looking back, what a coordinated attack that it had all happened in this particular way and in such a huge, in such a way that really affected everybody. And I know that so many people, I mean, the monastery was affected, people were trying to figure it all out. And it was a very disconcerting time. And newspapers in Dubai were calling me for a statement. You know, I was contacted by the person implanted in the Sangha, responsible for bringing this whole thing this whole thing out, was just started trying to contact me and seeking some sort of support or monetary help, and insinuating that his life was in danger. And you know, so the media contacted me in Dubai, then this person who was implanted in the Sangha was contacting me, and then I was getting questions about whether I was involved in questions about black magic, and I would end those conversations, and I retreated further and further away from the Sangha, you know. And even the Sangha in Dubai, I just kind of I was confused, didn't know what was happening, and just decided I would just be quiet and silent. And somehow felt that fearful. And I thought, because I was single, I was unmarried, I may be a target for attacks next. And I couldn't afford to have my parents or my family in any way affected. So I just kept away. So for 1 year, it was like, I didn't even want to see the news. And I didn't even want to look at what was happening. I didn't follow anything that was going on. Or all the attacks that were happening on Swamiji, on the Sangha, on the entire monastery, and what they were trying to do. And a year later, it was like almost like a post-traumatic stress response for me, 1 year away from my guru, who I had been so closely connected with for 6 years. And I just kind of, and the cognition that I had at the time was that I felt abandoned. I felt, you know, I dropped everything, and I just felt like, okay, I, you know, Swamiji's gone, I'm feeling abandoned, and in turn, I abandoned the Sangha and Swamiji, you know. So I just thought, okay, now this is what life is, and let me just do what everyone in society expects one to do, which is continue having your job, you know, live your comfortable lifestyle. And, you know, I was encouraged to settle down, get married, and my life just took a 180 from there on. It went in a completely different direction. And I didn't realize that that action, how much damage I was doing to myself, because I had a responsibility, not just to the Sangha in Dubai and to Swamiji, but to Sanatana Dharma, which in hindsight, I can see now. And I just thought I allowed myself to override my judgment, and logic took over, and logic took over and I just denied all the experiences I'd had until then, you know, experiences that defied logic. And all the love, all the compassion, all the protection, all the immeasurable growth, the healing, everything that I'd had experienced was just compartmentalized and put aside. And I didn't revisit it for 10 years, you know, and I didn't at that moment now, I didn't stand for the principles. I didn't stand with conviction, that simple devotion, that simple trust. I just abandoned it and buried it, you know, and I felt that the action at that moment in time, I didn't feel complete with it, because I did feel a responsibility towards the Middle Eastern Sangha. I had the opportunity to help the Sangha ride the wave of uncertainty till things became clearer, you know, till the dust settled and we actually could find out what the truth was. And I didn't, you know, so my reaction and then the lack of any action somewhat indicated my acceptance of this false narrative that was being spun around Swamiji and the Sangha. And it wasn't until March 2020, which is just last year, did I really understand or realize the magnitude of the persecution and the magnitude of the attacks on Swamiji, and how repeatedly the Sangha was under this attack and false allegations. And inside me, when I found all of this out, and now all of 10 years, I've kept an information blackout. And I didn't know any of this. And when I heard it, it unfurled in me a need to want to protect and stand, you know, and just this feeling of wanting to be like a warrior. And what I had not done in those 10 years, I was feeling like, this is what I need to do now. So the years that I was away, it's from the Sangha and Swamiji, those 10 years, I had repeated visions of Swamiji. And in those visions, I would go and ask, why did this happen? You know, and each time it was the same thing. And in that, Swamiji would say, come and see me. So I ignored those visions for several years. And then in 2017, right before I had my son, I had the vision of the banyan tree calling me. And then I knew that somehow I needed to return and be in the presence of the banyan tree. So then we had the opportunity. It unfolded in a way that was, again, defied logic. We happened to come to India after many, many years of being away. And one of the devotees who had been initiated into third eye powers did a body scan for me. And at that moment, the message to me that she got was, come and see me. There will be no hangover of the past. And those were the words exactly that I'd had in my visions all those years before. And the moment those words were said, I knew this was the time. And when they suggested that, oh, why don't we go to Adi Kailash? My immediate response was yes. And then immediately the rest of my family, my parents, my sister, my brother-in-law, all decided that we would go. And what stood out to me in all of this is that in these 10 years that I felt like I had separated, Swamiji was there every step of the way. He was trying to reach me through the visions that I had, any experiences that I'd had through my life in those 10 years that were challenging. There was a strength within me that I didn't realize I had. And looking back, I know that strength was Swamiji, you know, and despite me pulling away, that umbilical cord connection that you have with the guru, that spiritual umbilical cord, as far as you may go, that will always remain connected. And so now I can see in all those moments in those 10 years, just how Swamiji played such a role in my life to ensure that I didn't fall. You know, so those trying times, there was strength in those, in all those challenges, I was guided, I was protected. And I felt like, I didn't, like, Swamiji will never make one feel guilty or anything like that. So it wasn't that. I felt like there was a responsibility I had towards the Middle Eastern Sangha. I didn't stand for that. But now is the time, the opportunity has been given back to me that I can stand for it. And when I was given my spiritual name in 2004, it was already a strong indication. Nitya Atma Prema, which is the spiritual name initiated to me in 2004, was an indication of my purpose. And this is where, when I was living my purpose, is when I felt the most alive. And when I strayed far away from the guru, the sangha, and altered my path, there was so much incompletion. And I would often share with members of my family that I didn't feel like I had my purpose. And the only time I ever felt I had purpose was when I was doing work with and seva for Swamiji. And now thinking that the life that I'm living, maybe I'll find that purpose through a job, a different kind of project, or through marriage, or through having children, you know, but still there was something inside that was just unfulfilled. And the moment we stepped back into Adi Kailash in January of 2010, those 10 years just melted away. It felt like we were coming home, and that just knowing that it was with the guru's grace that we had that opportunity to come back. And no matter how far I went away, you know, the guru's hand was just always there, guiding, protecting, and ensuring that I have this second chance. And so when Devi Ma gave the message and said the reason for the pralaya is due to forgetting the purpose and diverting from the work I was meant to do, I felt it. I felt it deeply. And although 10 years may have passed, and the divine grace has pulled me back, and it's offering me a second chance. And what's important now is taking up that responsibility and standing up and actually living the purpose and aligning with that cosmic will now. So it's not about regret. It's not about feeling guilty. It's about coming to alignment and finding that completion and moving forward in alignment with that purpose, with powerfulness. And the responsibility is large. And I never want to take that for granted, because I know what anti-elements have been working now tirelessly for 10 years, incessantly attacking Sanatana Dharma, Swamiji, the Sangha, the entire... And the question is why? Why is this constant attack for 10 years? And I never want to let somebody else determine the purpose of my life, because the purpose is clear. And already those 10 years showed me just how much I had missed and how deeply unfulfilled I felt. And this is the chance to regain that and align myself. And Devi Ma strongly revealed what my soul felt, and now to live out that purpose is the ultimate gift that has happened with the guru's grace. So So this is a long sharing, Ma, and but I wanted to give context.
This is so much needed sharing, because you know what, it's not just you, you know, there are maybe hundreds of you know, devotees that are out there who became victim of the persecution, not just in terms of a direct attack, but victims of a persecution where the right information that was not given. The victims of the attack in the sense where, you know, the people who are also, whose life also got impacted because of the religious persecution and attack on Swamiji. And it's important that when you realize it, it took you 10 years to realize, and maybe there are so many that are still out there and who still have not realized, and who are listening to your sharing and who realize, oh God, this is exactly what I felt as well. You know, one side you have the wealth of experiences with Swamiji, which is our own experience. We know it, our inner being knows it, our consciousness knows it. We have felt it, we know Swamiji is. And every single devotee who has seen Swamiji, who has been touched by Swamiji, has that wealth of experiences. But what happens sometimes, you know, we may call it delusion, or we may call it whatever name we want, but that wealth of experiences, like you said, gets compartmentalized, and we get consumed by something else that's out there. And it takes us a while for us to spring back and realize, oh God, you know, these were my experiences with Swamiji, and I had them. I know who Swamiji is, and I know what this is. And it wakes us up. And the sooner we wake up, the sooner we realize the purpose of our life. And that's why it's very important, Mahatma, the people like you, when, you know, who were victims of the anti-Hindu attack on Swamiji, and which that led to you separating yourself from the Guru. And now you realize, oh God, you know, that's the time I should have been there and you know, stood a strong warrior for being a warrior for Sanatana Hindu Dharma, warrior for Swamiji, warrior for Kailasa. But you know, now that's what Devi has awakened. You know, I can see after the, you know, the Devi Parashakti Akashic reading, how much it's clicked in you, and how much it has revealed to you that, you know what, this is what has happened. And I'm so glad you're coming forward and sharing it for the benefit of others. You know, countless others that are out there, because the hate speech on Swamiji was, you know, spread all over media. Everything was spread all over media. And so many, one of the things that I wanted to ask you was, you know, the anti-Hindu elements, they tried to, when they were wanting to falsely implicate Swamiji in so many cases, right? Hundreds of false cases were slapped on Swamiji. And one of the things is they approached so many anti-Hindu elements approached so many female disciples and devotees of Swamiji and inviting them to be false witnesses, becoming false victims. And where you approached, you know, to be a false victim, or to be, they tried to pull you in into this whole attack against Swamiji.
Yes, Ma, it was a clear indication that was what I was being asked, not so subtly, because they contacted me and were trying to get me to be involved in this and to support their cause. And I immediately sensed that this is not where I am. This is not at all the space in which I'm in. This is, and I slowly retreated away from, you know, the contact with these people, and I didn't want to upset or anger, but I just detached myself from, because that was not at all, there was not even a moment to think in that way, and to be even approached about such a thing was just unbelievable for me. So from all the love, from all that was showered on us, you know, to even consider that was out of the realm of any possibility. So I think they understood that, and also trying to get some sort of monetary support and all of that. So it was, I can see how many would have been affected the same way that I was. And I was lucky, it was only just 10 years. There may be some people who, it may be longer, and I hope not, because if you are having that call, just listen to it, because that is the call from the divine saying, come back. You know, this is for that completion. I don't want to think about what would have happened had I not, and I wouldn't be here talking today and sharing this. In that moment, I never thought, like a few years later, I never thought that this would be where I would be sitting today and talking and even discussing this. But I think so many people may be in that same position, and allowing these attacks and this abuse and persecution to affect their spiritual growth and progress. And that would just be the saddest thing.
Exactly. And at the end of the day, it's a loss for us. It's a loss for each individual, because you are losing the more and more we are distancing ourselves from the Guru, the more and more we are distancing ourselves from the true purpose of life, the more and more we are distancing ourselves from what we are here for. Because it is the Guru, it is Swamiji who awakens us to the true purpose of life, makes us realize and experience fulfillment. And the moment we move away from the Guru, we move away from who we are, what we came here for. And that can never give us fulfillment, right? We can go and do so many different things. You can have the best of the best businesses, the best of the families, the best of, job and relationships and wealth, but that's not the best of you. So whatever you do, it does not give you that fulfillment. You know there is a deep lack, there is something that's missing. And you know that that is the divine call. Like you said, there are so many visions that happen. You know Swamiji is there for you, and you know that was where we need to come back to. And I can tell you, every single devotee who, was a devotee of Swamiji and was a victim of these attack of these anti-Hindu elements would also know that there has been a deep call. They just need to answer the call, answer that incoming call from Parameshiva and realign ourselves to the true purpose of life. And one of the things that you also shared, Mahatma Mahima, I wanted to bring these anti-Hindu elements, like how they approached you and wanting you to become one of the, the false victims. And that's what they have done. They have approached so many, female disciples of Supreme Pontiff and wanting to somehow trying to lure them to become a false victim of Swamiji, right? So if somebody is, let's say, for example, somebody is really affected, I would be the one who's affected. Because I'm affected, I'll go in and maybe complain somewhere. But nobody needs to come and tell me, oh, you know what? Why don't you come and falsely implicate? So the very intention of the anti-Hindu elements is very clear. And because they approached you to be a false victim yourself. So all of us should realize that the whole ecosystem, the anti-Hindu ecosystem, which was trying to attack Swamiji, trying to falsely implicate Swamiji, trying to assassinate him, trying to slap these hundreds of false cases, is a huge persecution against Sanatana Hindu Dharma. And because, like Swamiji in a very satsang sometime back, he said, I am being attacked because I am standing to protect Sanatana Hindu Dharma. I am standing up to protect all of you, and that's why I'm being attacked. He's standing up to protect the enlightenment ecosystem. He's standing to protect and revive Sanatana Hindu Dharma, and that is why he is attacked. But sometimes delusions and the illusions that we live in, our mind does not wake up to the reality of what's happening out there, and we end up losing or moving away from the purpose of life. And even at that point, it is only the incomparable compassion of Swamiji. Even then, even when we distance ourselves, he reaches out to us and he awakens us to the true purpose of life. So beautifully shared, Mahatma Prema. Is there anything else that you would like to share about your experience?
Just to share from this past year, from 2020 to today, 2021, the exponential, let me just say this. I live a life that's very comfortable. I've lived in many different countries. I've got the opportunity to travel, live with all luxuries. There's nothing that I am wanting for in life. Yet there was this deep unfulfillment that now in this past 1 year with Swamiji has just been immense growth, spiritual growth, evolution, healing, completion, immeasurable. There are things that I could share that are unbelievable for other people to. And in this 1 year, what has happened has been, this is how life around Swamiji is. It's just exponential. It's just that superconscious breakthrough after breakthrough, and the cognitions and everything. And I'm sure many people will attest to the same, obviously. And that's not something I can even imagine having missed. And the opportunity to be back and the opportunity to realign myself and get and come back to the true purpose is something I really pray for all the others who are victims of this, of these attacks.
So beautifully shared, Martha Prima. Thank you so much for coming live and sharing your experience with everybody. And thank you so much. I don't know what else to say. It's just been like, you know, it's not easy for somebody to come forward and share so openly, you know, what they have gone through and how you have been a victim of this attack and which separated you from Guru, distanced you from the purpose of your life. And now with Devi Parashakti's blessings, with Swamiji's blessings, I'm so glad that you realized you're back and you wanted to realign and become a part of Swamiji and Sangha. Thank you so much for coming forward and sharing, Ma.
Thank you, Ma. Thank you to Swamiji Nityanandam.
Nityanandam. Dear viewers, before we continue with the next segment of today's program, let's take a short break.